come here and share my research. I have to say that it's a great idea that Scott initiated this theory, because for a young researcher like me, any kind of prize would be good for my CV and so on. So, but I hope you will enjoy the research that I'm going to talk now. I will talk about predicting DNA regulatory regions using human genomics, transcriptomics, and epigenetics data. So this work has been done by a group at CSIRO, led by Professor Brian Dalrymple. This is CSIRO. I have a question for you at the end of this talk or this session. If you answer right, I have a gift from Australia for you. So what is this in the symbol? Ah, there's another one. An interesting one. So I will hold on with that one. But now I move to another photo. That is this one. So you may know that this is the first genetically engineered cattle. And what's special about this is it doesn't have horns. And this is very important in the meat and dairy industry. And the more interesting thing is the target for genome editing in here is not in the coding gene, but it's outside the coding region. So what happened in there? After today's talk, I hope I will convince you about the mechanism of how genome editing targeted outside the gene can make the cattle become horn ponies. So let's start. But it doesn't move, so I will. First of all, why are we interested in DNA regulatory regions? So at CSIRO, we are part of this international consortium called Functional Annotation of Animal Genome, in short, FAN. So nowadays, there are just so many hundreds of genome assemblies that are available, but so little information that we know about what are the functional parts of the genome. What we know is maybe 2% of the genome, that is the coding region. But most of the species share very similar genome sequence and the number of genes. So what makes species different? I would say that it's the control of gene expression that distinguishes species in usual scan disease. So how the gene expression is controlled is mainly here. This is a very simplified model that basically tells the complete story. So in the genome, we have a gene, a target gene, but outside the gene region, we have a somewhere in blue here that we don't know, but we also have the yellow region in here that's promoter, and some region that outside and very, very far away from the gene. This one here, the histone enhancer. So these are the DNA regions that contain the binding site for what we call protein transcription factors. And these make the transcriptional control machinery. So I would like to convince you after today that in order to use our genome information effectively, we need to explore beyond the protein coding region, that is to know the regulatory sequence. Okay. Then, how do we identify regulatory regions? It's very complicated experimentally, so people need to combine many different types of data. Essentially, we need epigenetics data, including histone modification, DNA methylation, and then we need genomics data, like open chromatin assays, or chromatin interaction assays. We also need transcriptomics data like unlacing or page. Let me give you one example here, like this promoter. The way we can tell that this is a promoter because we base on the index one region. So we can say that this is the region where the genome is open. And then we, based on the histone modification, the histone 3 lysine 4 trimethylation, if that signal is high, then this region is highly likely to be promoted. So that is how we combine different types of genomics, epigenetics, and transcriptomics data to predict the regulatory regions. So in human, there's a lot of data out there. There are data for many different tissues, cell types, and many types of assays. And the data is available in the publicly databases, like in the form of atlases, like this, or encyclopedia. So unfortunately, for most of the other species, we don't have that luxury. We have very little data. The idea is that we can use the computational method to utilize this type of data and predict similar functional regions in a species of interest. So that is the idea. And then we developed a method called HPIS, which is the short form for human projection of regulatory sequences, or it can be also target research. And so in the HPIS, what we do is we try to predict three broad categories of regulatory regions. The first one is the promoters, which is the region here, near the coding gene, a bit more proximal to the coding gene. And the second one is the enhancer. It can be anywhere, it can be even in the other chromosome, but can loop to somewhere near to the gene and bring the transcription factor near to the gene and trigger the transcription. And the third category is other. So it can be many types, but basically they can be generalized as the region where the transcription factor applies to. So these are three types of regulatory regions that this type like here will predict. So in the HPIS pipeline, there are three steps. So the first one is to map. So we try to get information from human. We map to a species of interest, like we map to cow, we map to pig, we map to dog, for example. And after mapping, we will use a filter pipeline to reduce the noise. Then we will have a good data set for us to apply in quite many different areas, like to predict how DNA variants affect the phenotype, or to predict a good target for genome editing. So now I will go through these three steps from one by one. Okay, so let's start with mapping. To map, we need to know which data set in human are best for us to use to map to our species. So we have a optimized the protocol, and we found out that the best combination of data sets would be to have the most diverse types of tissues, cell lines, and assay types. For example, in here, this is to show the number of enhancers we can predict from 88 tissues. We can see that the range of the number is quite high. But one striking feature in here is that the tissues that are biologically relevant to the enhancer that we are interested in will be the tissue that produce the highest number. And if you look at different databases, you can see that some databases share a core set of gene region, like this, but each database will have some more unique region in. So that is why we try to combine many different data sets together to start the mapping. And in fact, we use about 8 million sequences from ENCODE, ROMAP, Phantom, and sample all the big international consortium. That represents about 1,000 tissues and cell lines with different sequencing technology like this. So by starting with that combined data set, we expect to get to a mapped result that can cover most of the enhancer promoters and transcription factor database in the target species. So the next step of the mapping is to use the selected database and start to look for similar sequence in the target species, in this case the target the species in the cattle. And we optimize the method in a way that we use the interspecies conservation at two levels. The third level is the primary sequence conservation. By this, here we have an exact conservation or exact similarity in terms of the sequence. But we also allow some flexibility there. There can be some mutation in here or some changes during the evolution. We allow that flexibility. But in order to have that flexibility, we require another criteria, that is the reciprocal mapping. If we can map the region from here to here, then we should be able to map the region from here back to here. So that is when we consider together, that is quite a stringent criteria. We also apply another strategy, like if we have a gene duplication event during the evolution, at least from this region, we have two genes in the same region. Then this may be the real one, and if we have a high similarity between this region and this region, then we can consider as this is a potential regulatory region in the new species as well. There are cases that we cannot map, like here. There's no similarity. That is in cattle compared to humans. So this is a species-specific regulatory region. So in this case, we cannot detect it, and that's a limitation of the method. So we have tried to optimize many parameters. For example, here I show one example that we look at the similarity score, and when we reduce the similarity threshold, we can increase the number of regions recover from the mapping, and there are a number of other parameters as well. Here is one example there. So after we have the mapping, we have a data set result that contains many regulatory regions, and we call this universal data set because that's the result of the mapping from thousands of tissues in humans with many different data types. So that universal data set is expected to contain all possible regulatory regions. And we use that universal data set to put it through the filtering pipeline. So the idea of applying the filtering pipeline is to remove the noise, the possible mapping error, and to select the region with high likelihood of being the real regulatory region. So we have seven different sets, different filtering. Each of the filtering will select for one specific feature of the regulatory region. For example, if we use this histone 3 lysine 27 estimation as a signal, we select for the enhancer. So this is filter one. If you look at the filter one in here, we can recover many of the enhancers, so some of the promoters, but in both cases, we have more enhancer and promoter than in the genome baseline. So that means the filtering work, and the expected filter type also give us the expected result. Similarly, with other seven filter there. After each filtering process, we could get some enrichment of promoter and enhancer compared to the baseline. So after applying these seven filtering, we would expect to have a filter data set that has much higher promoter and enhancer compared to the baseline, and higher also compared to the universal data set. So here I'm showing one example of the cattle genome, where we map human data to the cattle genome, and we recover what we call universal data set. Then we put this universal data set through the seven filtering steps. In each step, if it passes the filter, we will recover a set of regulatory regions with more motor and enhancers compared to the baseline. After the seventh step, we will pull all of these seven data sets together and make up the future data set. At the end, this is the result we will get. We will get much higher enrichment of regulatory regions in the future data set compared to the baseline and compared to the universal data set. So that is the idea of how we use the filtering process to enrich all real regulatory regions. And we apply this type for other 10 mammalian species that range from rat, mouse, pig, cow, rabbit, dog, cat, monkey. So we found out that for species that are evolutionarily close to human, we can detect more of the regulatory regions up to 90%. For species that are a bit further away in the evolution of the tree, we still recover about 65% of the regulatory region. And we also observe a consistent trend between the tissue. When we have a tissue that more similar to the tissue we are looking at, in this case in the river, we would have a more discovery of the enhanced epimotor for the prediction using river and the original human data set. And if we only use one tissue, we could get very low recovery, but if we combine together, we can get up to 90%. That's if this pipeline can be applied to other species, mammalian species. Even I have a try with chicken, and I have a colleague who is trying the pipeline with fish in salmon. So now, let's say we have a good filter data set. What are possible use of this result? I will present three examples. The first one would be to use the DNA variant at the genome scale to predict the phenotype. So this is quite a common application in the industry right now, especially in agriculture. People use a SNP array to phenotype the cattle, for example, and predict what is the breeding value of this parental pair. So in order to do that, usually we need to design a good SNP array that contains the SNPs that are near the what we call the functional SNPs that cause the phenotype. But at the moment, there's no such optimal way of selecting which is the good SNP. The size of the SNP between every pair of two individuals would be tens of millions of SNP in every two genomes. But the SNP chip itself can often contain 50,000 SNPs, that would be 0.5 of the total SNPs. So that means we need to have an optimal way to prioritize which SNP we use to include in the array. I would give you one example here where we looked at a SNP in 32 traits in the 10,000 cattle. And we look at the count of SNP in the regulatory region in purple here. So we all see the higher number of SNP in the regulatory region compared to other types of genomic regions. So that means the result of the HPIS can be used for designing the SNP array. So I will go very quickly in the last two slides. So this is another example of using the HPIS result to prioritize the functional SNP. So we can look at this panel here. There's a gene, and this is motor, regulatory region, and these are the SNPs. So there are 13 SNPs that can be causal SNPs contributing to the phenotype in the structure phenotype. The problem is we don't know which SNP is the important one. But if you look at the HPIS results in here, we immediately see that there are two SNPs that overlap the promoter. So these two SNPs can be a good candidate for like mentally validate that they are causative SNPs. And in fact, in this paper, the author has confirmed that. this is a, coming back to our initial slide, this is the post phenotype, and there are two possible partial mutations in here. One is the lesion and one is this interpretation. Which one causes the phenotype? But from our position, we say that is this one, and we have more details about how this condition may happen to cause this phenotype. So this is a summary. I will just go very quickly. And this is the campus that we are in, so it's very beautiful. If you visit in the future, please contact me. I will show you around. Thank you very much. Good morning.